Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Decolonial Marxism, Essays from the Pan-African Revolution by Walter Rodney. Narrated by Terrence Kidd. Foreword. Walter Rodney completes Marx. Ngugi wa Thiong'o. Colonization, with all its interlinked economic, political, cultural, and even psychic dimensions, has been central to the making of capitalist modernity. It was the new colonies in the West that fueled Atlantic slave trade with the African body as commodity, and slavery, with the African body providing unpaid labor for the colonial plantations, and racism, with all its dehumanization of the African body and mind, negation of the African humanity. All these fueled the development of Europe and the West. The major cities of Europe were built by riches from slave trade, slavery, and colonialism. Three of the major nuclear powers today, the USA, Britain, and France, were also major players in enslavement and colonization. Western modernity is rooted in the looting of a continent. But one of the most frequently propagated colonial mythologies is that of Europe and the West having developed Africa. All the major thinkers of the European Enlightenment, from Hume to Kant and Hegel, advanced the same thesis, also embodied in missionary and explorer narratives about the continent. The myth continues today, with the West seen as donor to Africa. It was Walter Rodney who best articulated a refutation of that mythology, and is now universally acclaimed classic, How Europe Underdeveloped Africa. This and Fanon's The Wretched of the Earth are really the basic material for helping make sense of the contradictions which still haunt Africa and all the formerly colonized of Asia and South America. The African post-colonial elite is very protective of their phony identities, Francophone, Anglophone, and Lusophone, but they are never protective of the resources of the continent. 90% of these resources, including diamonds, gold, oil, copper, cobalt, uranium, are still owned by Western corporations. Africa, the biggest continent in the world, continues to be the main donor to Europe and the West. See the contradiction. Europe gave Africa the resources of their accents, the basis of those phony identities. Africa gave Europe access to the resources of the continent. Accents for access. That is really the story of Africa's underdevelopment by Europe, well captured and analyzed by Walter Rodney. Rodney was able to do this because of his Marxian approaches to history, which enabled him to see clearly the intertwinement of economics, politics, culture, and values, which, under capitalism, rest on the primary contradiction between labor and capital. But he was able to add the racial and colonial dimension to this. Race, gender, and colonialism were integral to development of capitalism to its current stage of global imperialism. Colonization is colonizer and colonized. So decolonization at the economic, political, cultural, and psychic levels has to involve both the colonizer and the colonized. Even our methodologies need to be decolonized from their Eurocentric basis. Marxist class analysis needs the dimensions of race and colony and gender to complete it. These essays, Decolonial Marxism, will be an important companion to our continued learning from the same Pan-African mind that showed us clearly how Europe underdeveloped the continent. With the dimensions of race and colony added to class analysis, Rodney completes Marx. Part 1. Marxist Theory and Mass Action. 1. A Brief Tribute to Amilcar Cabral. In Amilcar Cabral, Africa had a giant who bridged the gap between theory and practice, and hence represented the embodiment of revolutionary praxis. Cabral was a theoretician of the highest caliber, but only because he was involved in changing the ugly realities of colonized African society. He supervised a people's war of liberation with great distinction, but only because of the soundness of his scientific worldview and his capacity to apply it penetratingly to the social relations of Guinea-Bissau. The few pages which Cabral devoted to an analysis of the African societies of Guinea-Bissau are of extraordinary perceptiveness and authenticity. This is understandable, since the accuracy of the interpretation was literally a matter of life and death. The massive task of political mobilization that the African Party for the Independence of Guinea and Cape Verde, Partido Africano de Independencia de Guinea y Cabo Verde, PAIGC, so strikingly achieved was based on a correct appreciation of such niceties as the relations between youth and elders among the Balanta people, or ties between a quasi-feudal Fula lord and his aliens, or the role of the itinerant Manding trader within the colonial economy. Based on this political mobilization, the military conflict has in turn been decidedly resolved in favor of the PAIGC in most parts of Guinea-Bissau. It is the element of commitment which sets Cabral apart from the common run of intellectuals who boast of being neutral and unbiased, thereby passively accepting the perpetuation of the colonial status quo. At the same time, Cabral's work as a revolutionary African intellectual also contrasts sharply with the purpose of the early European anthropologists who openly oriented their study towards the maintenance of colonial rule by writing intelligence reports for the occupying power. Cabral was serving as an intelligence officer of the Army of Liberation when he unraveled the intricacies of segmentary lineage groups and the stratified social formations which exist in Guinea-Bissau. The fact that the Portuguese colonial regime has virtually fallen apart, in contrast to the surging growth in the area of liberated Guinea, is the ultimate proof of the reactionary nature of the colonial relationship and the progressive character of the intellectual work carried out by Cabral and his colleagues. Paradoxical as it may seem, Cabral, leader of a nationalist movement, was constantly playing down the importance of mere nationalism. He did so through perceiving the difference between a political outlook limited to nationalism and one which encompassed a revolutionary transformation of the people's lives along socialist lines. It is this revolutionary transformation that was the supreme objective in Cabral's eyes. This he stressed on the innumerable occasions when he stood before the villagers of Guinea-Bissau. He put it to them that independence is not just a simple matter of expelling the Portuguese, of having a flag and a national anthem. The people must be secure in the knowledge that no one is going to steal their labor, that the wealth of the country is not going into somebody else's pocket. Even today, the Guinean people stand naked and are still afraid of the river, the rain, and the forest. We tell the Guinean people that by their work, the river will be tamed and the rain will be put to good use. Here was the straightforward language meant to fortify against further manifestations of neocolonialism, the growth of a national bourgeoisie, and the perpetuation of ignorance and fear among the masses. Cabral saw that the nationalist struggle chronologically preceded the socialist revolution, but that it was imperative to prepare for the subsequent socialist revolution from the onset of the national phase. Armed struggle was the unavoidable path to the liberation of Guinea. Yet, politics has remained in command throughout. The PAIGC has constantly involved itself in the cadre formation, mass mobilization, and the creation of democratic socialist structures and attitudes. All of these programs benefited from the long-term vision of Amilcar Cabral, leader of the PAIGC since its inception in September 1956. For those of us who aspire towards a deeper appreciation of historical dialectics, Cabral's analyses are models for study. One doubts whether even the skeptic can remain unimpressed by the strength and flexibility of his arguments concerning the roles of respective strata and classes within the Guinean Revolution. Cabral broke away from a rigid categorization of this or that class as reactionary or revolutionary. Instead, he was concerned with the dual revolutionary-reactionary potential of most of the elements involved in the nationalist struggle. He examined the specifics of Guinean society and pinpointed the methods by which revolutionary potential could be realized under the guidance of the PAIGC. Frantz Fanon, perhaps more than anyone else, is responsible for popularizing the notion of the revolutionary nature of the African peasantry. Speaking at the Frantz Fanon Center in Milan, Cabral found it necessary to caution that while the peasantry had the greatest objective interest in the struggle, the peasantry was not a revolutionary force. Rather, it constituted the principal physical force available to the armed struggle. The contradiction between himself and Fanon is more apparent than real. What Cabral is warning against is the facile conclusion drawn by some that the peasants will be spontaneously revolutionary. Bitter experience has shown that this is not true, even for the industrial working class, in spite of the highly socialized nature of industrial production. Cabral was, in effect, renewing the battle against the concept of revolutionary spontaneity, and restating the case for painstaking mobilization by the most conscious elements. Then, and only then, would the peasantry become a revolutionary force. Great political leaders derive their stature from their relationship to a given social class, usually when that class is on the ascendant. In this instance, Cabral's greatness is tied into the forward movement of the laboring population of the Guinea-Bissau, Africa, and the Third World. Not only is he a product and spokesman for that movement, but he has been an active agent in molding the force of change in an anti-imperialist direction. Indeed, one can say that Amilcar Cabral still remains an active agent working against imperialism, both through the legacy of his thought and in the structures he left behind. It would be idle and dangerous to deny that the enemy still has the capacity to sow divisions and cause confusion within the Guinean liberation movement. Cabral's own assassination is testimony to this effect. But at a certain point, a movement becomes irreversible, and all the efforts of the enemy smack of desperation and insanity, as we have seen in the last days before the Vietnamese people achieved their historic victory over U.S. imperialism. Victory in Guinea-Bissau for the popular forces in Angola and in Mozambique is the only justification that Cabral would require, and on all fronts, that victory is in the making. 2. Masses in Action. Over the past decade, Guyana has been stirred into a state of constant self-examination. The results, however, have been meager and disappointing, largely because the discussion has been confined to the period after 1953 and to the personalities, failures, and recriminations of that era. There is a tacit assumption that only in 1953 did mass involvement in Guyanese political affairs begin, national political leaders arise, and racial suspicion and strife find expression. Guyanese history began a long time ago. Even the beginning of the 20th century is an arbitrary and not entirely satisfactory point at which to take up the story of the Guyanese masses. But it does allow some scope for at least an interim examination of the Guyanese past in terms which are relevant to the working class. By the end of the 19th century, the net result of nearly three centuries of varied activity by external forces on the Guyana mainland was the creation of a small society limited to the coastlands, to the production of sugar, and to all that went with sugar in terms of class stratification and foreign exploitation. Today, the fundamentals of the situation remain unaltered, with sugar accounting for more than 40% of national revenues. Yet the old colonial system had its critics, the most serious of all possible critics, the working masses. It is the contention here that both the marginal modification of an entirely sugar-bound society and the hostility evoked by that society are to be traced to the years after 1900, and in particular to the period of the First World War. Bauxite. In the economic sphere, the principal supplement to sugar in Guyana today is bauxite. At the outbreak of the First World War, a number of mining concessions were issued when geological evidence indicated that extensive deposits of bauxite were likely to be encountered in Guyana. The largest concession was held by the Demerara Bauxite Company, which was registered locally in 1916, backed by American and Canadian financial interests. The Demerara Bauxite Company built the town of Mackenzie before the end of the war. And early in November 1919, there was a Chronicle report that the company had just exported 1,500 tons of bauxite, its fourth shipment. All Guyanese welcomed the discovery of bauxite, but there was a revealing debate about the role of American capital when it was ascertained that the Northern Alumina Company of Toronto, of which the Demerara Bauxite Company was a subsidiary, was merely a facade for U.S. capitalists. Primarily, the question was posed in terms of British imperial interests versus those of the United States. And in fact, the British government suspended the granting of mineral concessions in Guyana during the latter stages of the war, with the hope that British capital would give a better account of itself after the struggle in Europe had ended. But there was also the underlying assumption in the Guyanese press that local interest could well have been jeopardized by U.S. capital, and local entrepreneurs demanded the opportunity to be allowed to raise capital and take the initiative in the bauxite industry. As it turned out, the North American financiers and industrialists had the field to themselves. The Demerara Bauxite Company quickly joined forces with and took partial control of Spostrons, the most important engineering and shipping firm in Guyana at that time, and together they came to dominate the Demerara River and with it a significant section of the economy. Growth of U.S. imperialism in Latin America. Stimulated by wartime conditions, trade between Guyana and the United States was on the increase, and imports from the U.S. were rapidly outstripping imports from Britain. Guyana was but a small part of a process of development taking place in the whole Latin American and Caribbean area. In Jamaica, the U.S. had gone further towards capturing the local market than in any other British West Indian territory, while in Suriname, it was also U.S. capital which had started the bauxite industry. This new U.S. offensive was a further stage in the decline of European influence in the Southern Americas, a process which started with the Haitian Revolution. The 19th century had already shown that European decline meant replacement by U.S. domination. This situation was being seriously discussed in the Caribbean and Latin America at the end of the First World War. The Argosy gave prominence to a discourse by an Argentine intellectual on the dangers that were imminent because of U.S. imperialism. All the British West Indian islands were particularly concerned that the British were planning to relinquish their Caribbean possessions to the United States. The answer to this new threat, they felt, was a federation, though curiously enough, this too was envisaged in broad, hemispheric terms to include Canada. Subsequently, the hopes of a federation were dashed, while the fears that the British would relinquish their possessions to the U.S. were fully justified in every respect except that of international law. Simultaneously with bauxite, the more glamorous attraction of diamonds was presented. By 1922, the diamond industry was flourishing, accounted in value for one quarter of the exports of Guyana. Since gold had been discovered in 1882, with rubber and balata providing further incentives, and with bauxite and diamonds in the offing too, it is not surprising that the bush acquired a new meaning for Guyanese, and the habit of looking inland was probably enhanced by the partial breakdown of the traditional relations with Europe, which the war affected. During the war, people keenly debated the feasibility of such schemes as a road to link up with the main Pan-American highway and a railway deep into the hinterland, while an economic survey of the Rupununi region was proposed. The parallel with Guyana of 1966 is striking. The interior can be seen to represent, in the consciousness of the Guyanese, an escape from the insular and colonial relations of the narrow coastal strip, and, incidentally, it is clear that the masses are taking the initiative in the matter. This consciousness, for obvious geographical reasons, is absent from the islands of the Caribbean, but it is not unique so far as the mainland territories are concerned. A modern historian sees the most characteristic element of Latin American history as being its El Dorado spirit, And that spirit was perfectly exemplified by the Guyanese pork knocker, as well as being shared by those who remained behind. Precious little emerged out of the hope that the interior offered Guyana a brighter future. All that came of the scheme of communication with the hinterland was the Rupununi Cattle Tract, which was opened in 1917. The gold rush of the 1880s had declined considerably in the early years of the 20th century. Mushroom companies had collapsed as yields proved unremunerative, and the diamond industry was to follow a similar pattern. Both minerals continued to produce regular revenue, but the scale of operations was small. At a glance, it seems that the Guyanese had overestimated their resources, but it was those who believed that the country had only minor alluvial deposits of gold and diamonds, but no supplies at great depth, who were living in a world of fancy. The woeful ignorance and apathy of the colonial regime militated against the rational utilization of Guyana's resources. Indentured immigration. The conception of change which the Guyanese workers entertained during the war was by no means restricted to the exploration of the interior. On a number of vital fronts, they were prepared to wage a struggle against the forces of oppression. One of their most crucial battles was for an end to indentured immigration and subsequently for the prevention of exploitation of the same ilk. There were veiled indications in the Guyanese press that when McNeil and Cheman Lau, the two commissioners from India, visited Guyana in 1916 to investigate the indenture system, they were carefully guided to their sources of information, and there were strong assertions on the part of the Indian and Negro workers that they had struggled uncompromisingly against the system of indenture. The commissioner's report was not decisively condemnatory, but in any event, 18 April 1917 saw the arrival of the last ship bringing indentured immigrants from India. By the time that the last indentured contracts were served, all sectors of the society became nominally free. Indenture, unlike slavery, was constantly producing free citizens in large numbers, some of whom were repatriated at the expiry of their contract. Indeed, the rate of repatriation was quite high. In the 20 years between 1891 and 1911, a total of 36,016 Indian immigrants returned home, compared with the 65,764 who arrived during the same period. Many of the Indians who remained in Guyana, like the freed Negroes, moved away from the sugar estates and attempted to set themselves up as independent peasantry. In 1890, 30% of the East Indians earned their living outside of the sugar estates, while by 1911, less than half of those labored brought to Guyana in the interest of the sugar industry were still to be found on the sugar estates. The population of Guyana in December 1917 was 314,000, out of whom 137,000 were Indians, and only 62,000 of them were laboring on the sugar estates. Rice. Rice provided the basis for the East Indian withdrawal from the sugar plantations. Some African slaves and their descendants had planted rice in Guyana and elsewhere, but it was not a crop that was widespread in West Africa, in contrast to India, from where the indentured immigrants brought techniques of irrigated rice farming. As early as 1905, Guyanese rice imports began to drop, and shortly afterwards, the local rice industry was not only taking care of the domestic consumption, but was also exporting. Under wartime conditions, the rice industry was able to set its sights clearly on exports, because it was easy to capture the West Indian market, which was starved of food imports. In Guyana itself, there were food shortages, making it necessary for an embargo to be placed on the export of rice in 1917. However, in March 1919, permits were once more issued for the export of rice to the West Indian Islands, so that the rice industry emerged from the crucible of the war as Guyana's second agricultural activity. Naturally enough, the East Indian peasants wanted land. The planter and the government attitude towards the settlement of indentured immigrants on small holdings was not initially favorable, but both in Trinidad and Guyana, they were prepared to grant small amounts of land if this would keep labor from returning to India. Besides, the land had to be properly drained and irrigated for rice farming, and the crop needed to be financed and marketed. All these problems have only been successfully tackled in the last few years, so that for decades, the rice farmers waged a constant struggle against drought and flood, and against the voraciousness of the Georgetown merchants who advanced credits and then bought the paddy of rice at ridiculously low prices. Yet, for all this, the East Indian peasant, like the ex-slaves who had managed to set up free villages in Guyana, had to some extent escaped the toils of the plantation system, and it is probably significant that, according to Chandra Jayawardena, the Indians of the rice-growing villages consider the Indian plantation laborers to be disorderly and immoral. Throughout the Caribbean, the heritage of sugar is one of degradation. Indian middle class. While the mass of the East Indian population was either laboring on the sugar estates or in the rice fields, there were also small numbers of merchants and professional men of the race, already prominent by 1917, precisely because indenture had long been producing free citizens. Clearly, such individuals had already acquired interest quite different from the East Indian workers and peasants. It was an East Indian landowner and rice miller, Guy Dean, who was a principal opponent to the scheme of setting up a cooperative rice mill when this was proposed late in 1918. His intention was that the peasants should be entirely dependent on him, and he issued a thinly veiled threat to increase the rent of the ground in the houses of the East Indian peasants over whom he held the whip hand. Viraswamy, a Georgetown lawyer, was accused of hypocritical posturing when he called upon the East Indian workers of Guyana to fight for king and country, while allowing himself to be persuaded that he was too valuable an asset to Guyana to risk enlistment. However, it was the small East Indian section of the middle class to whom the indentured and ex-indentured immigrants looked for guidance and leadership. And in turn, the lawyers and merchants sought to articulate the interest of the East Indian community as a whole. For instance, when there was a serious disagreement on a sugar estate, the laborers would trek to Georgetown and seek the assistance of prominent individuals like Luckhoo and Viraswamy. Racial consciousness. It appears that by the 1890s, the East Indians had begun to consolidate some sort of community life. By 1917, there were 46 mosques and 43 temples, while only two temples had been seen by a royal commission in 1870. The end of indenture, though not as decisive as the end of slavery, produced a new wave of communal feeling among the East Indians of Guyana, one of the products of which was the British Guyana East Indian Association. The idea was put into practice on the initiative of Mr. Mudhoo Lal Bose and the other signatories of the first circular calling for the formation of the association were J.V. Opry, Rampersad Saw, E. Kamal, J.D. Rohi, M. Ishmael, A.S. Ruhrmann, and Peter Ruhrmann. On 13 February 1919, the association came into being with Mr. J. Luckhoo as the first president. The aims and objects of the British Guyana East Indian Association were the social, intellectual, and moral improvement of its members by means of debates, lectures, writing of essays, and the provision of library and recreational facilities. After some disagreement, it was decided that the association should also indulge in political activities. The association also published Indian Opinion as its official organ, championing the cause of the East Indians in Guyana. In addition, there was a keen interest in the affairs of the Indian subcontinent. The editorial of an early issue of Indian Opinion, published in May 1919, dealt with the recent disturbances in India and the affairs of the Indian National Congress. There was a simultaneous resurgence of Negro racial consciousness. It was also linked to the end of indenture, since discussions of the role and status of the East Indians in Guyana inevitably involved comparisons with the Negroes. But even more decisive was the impact of the American Negro struggle. The government twice attempted to pass legislation in 1918 and 1919 against the importation of American Negro literature, which was widely read among the Guyanese Negro masses. The end of the war saw the attempts of the Pan-African movement to lobby the peace conference in France. Meetings were held in various places, notably in the town halls of Georgetown and New Amsterdam, to discuss the question of sending a delegate to Versailles. Letters to the press, lectures and sermons on the problems of the Negro were all common, drawing frequently on examples from the U.S. By 1923, the Negro masses had formed organizations such as the Georgetown branch of the Universal Negro Improvement Association, Marcus Garvey's, the African Communities League, and the Negro Progress Convention. The relatively small Portuguese community also sought to organize itself around the Portuguese Benevolent Society. There was much talk among them of their Portuguese patrimony, of the need to preserve the Portuguese language in Guyana, and of the desirability of a Portuguese political party. The class struggle. Coexisting with the emphasis on racial identity was a powerful upsurge of class consciousness. The Reverend M. A. Kosu, speaking at Mackenzie in February 1919, remarked that if, as President Wilson has said, the world must be safe for democracy, the relations between capital and labor must be of the best. 3 months later, the preamble to a resolution of workers in Georgetown proceeded as follows: that this meeting of the working classes in the city of Georgetown and delegates from various associations of the working classes in the electorate of the counties of Demerara, Essequibo, Berbice, and the town of New Amsterdam expresses, etc. These were typical expressions of the awareness of the fundamental class contradictions in the society. Rising prices. During the war, prices had rocketed. A commission appointed to prepare a report on the salaries of civil servants found that, on average, the cost of living had increased 150% by 1918. What improvement would the end of the war bring? This was the principal question posed by Guyanese as the conflict in Europe neared an end. In December 1918, shortly after the armistice of the previous November, Reverend R.T. Frank, a great champion of the workers, warned them not to expect too much. In particular, he was gloomy but realistic in his assessment that the cost of living would not fall. He urged the formation of labor unions, and it was precisely the high prices of goods during and after the war that forced the workers to organize themselves. Dockers' agitation. As early as 1905, H.N. Critchlow, then 18 years old and a dock laborer, conceived with some other waterfront workers the idea of going on strike for higher wages. It was put into practice that very year, precipitating widespread rioting, which was answered by the guns of the police. When another attempt at strike action was made the following year, Critchlow, as the spokesman of the dock workers, was brought before the city magistrate on a charge of preventing a laborer named Abraham Ritchie from earning an honest living. The charge was dropped, but so was the scheme for striking. It was not until 1916 that a new move was made. The hours of work for waterfront laborers at that time were 6:30 a.m. to 6 p.m., with an interval of 1 hour for breakfast. The dockers determined that the hour should be reduced and that the wages of 64 cents per day should be increased to 84 cents. With the help of J. Sidney MacArthur, a Georgetown barrister, and Nelson Cannon, a member of the Court of Policy, they prepared a petition to the government. When this failed, militant strike action gained the workers their demands. The first success of the waterfront workers in 1916 was an empty one, since prices continued to spiral. And in September 1918, they returned to the attack. Led once more by Critchlow, they demanded increases for both casual and full-time workers, a different system of payment, and a reduction of hours. The dockers bargained astutely, drawing up a detailed cost of living index showing the increases in the prices of foodstuffs and other essentials. Working a full 6-day week of 69 hours, regular employees could earn a maximum of only $4.80 per week, which was manifestly inadequate when placed against the cost of living index. The Chamber of Commerce, which handled the negotiations for Booker's and other Water Street firms, claimed that they were not responsible for the rise in the prices of basic foodstuffs, and they were at first prepared to grant an increase of no more than 1 shilling per week. The dockers were adamant and won their point. In a final letter conceding victory to the workers, the Chamber of Commerce added ominously that the council hopes that this will place a period on recurring demands. The length of the dockers' working day then stood at 9 hours. The 8-hour day became the next rallying cry of these workers, and claims for this were pressed on the Chamber of Commerce early in December 1918. The Chamber had already hinted that they intended to call a halt to any further improvements in the lot of the dockers, and they now expressed extreme regret and surprise that the laborers, within 6 weeks of a generous and liberal concession of all the terms demanded in their petition dated 16th September 1918, should again approach the Chamber for further concessions. The merchants claimed that since the beginning of the war, the scale of payment had risen by nearly 100%, and to knock off 1 hour from the 9-hour day would mean, in effect, another increase of 10%. The Chamber's continued rejection of the dockers' claim for the 8-hour day was categorical, leaving no room for bargaining. Thus, in January 1919, militant strike action was decided upon, leading directly to the formation of the British Guiana Labor Union. The British Guiana Labor Union, BGLU. The BGLU celebrates its anniversary on 11 January, but the organization, which was in existence on 11 January 1919, seems to have been no more than a porters' union, an unofficial entity called into being by the waterfront strike. It was on 6 April that a meeting was held at the Unique Friendly Society in Regent Street, at which Critchlow proposed a resolution for the establishment of a labor union, and this was carried. Two representatives of Booker's were also invited, and from them came the suggestion for the formation of an industrial council for settling disputes between the dockers and the Water Street employees. The three-man council met shortly afterwards and recommended the 8-hour day and certain wage increases. Out of the agitation of the dockers arose an organization which transcended their own struggle. As one correspondent to the Argosy pointed out, the tense post-war labor situation in the world at large, which was regularly treated in the Guyanese press, could not help but influence the Guyanese proletariat. It was a testimony to the revolutionary mood of labor throughout the land that requests started pouring in for membership of the BGLU from various parts of the country. In April, a meeting at Victoria, East Coast Demerara, decided in favor of a labor union branch for the area. The following month, the workers of Bagotville, West Coast Demerara, followed suit. These were typical examples of the movement that led to the rapid establishment of a countrywide workers' organization. All sectors of labor were involved, including tradesmen. The first president, M. Hosanna, was a tailor, and there were even jibes that residents of the almshouse or old people's home were allowed to join the union. This came about because the union was also a friendly and burial society, thus grafting itself onto one of the oldest forms of social organization that the masses of Guyana had experienced. The BGLU had a wide base of direct industrial action. The latter portion of 1919 and most of 1920 witnessed a succession of disputes and strikes involving, among others, the railways, the electric company, the sawmills, sugar estates, the Argosy, and the docks. The pressure of this agitation, carried on by manual workers, was sufficient to gain advantages even for the Water Street clerks, though it was not surprising that these white-collar workers never showed real loyalty to the workers' movement. The first annual general meeting in 1920 was something of a fiasco, and the union nearly disintegrated. Membership fell from a peak of 13,000 to a few hundred, but the union continued to function as a pressure group. By 1923, the delegates to the General Conference could look back on a few years of solid achievement. One union campaign had led to the passage early in 1922 of a rent restriction bill. There was a rumor in January 1923 that the Rent Act was about to be repealed, and the workers prepared to resume the fight if necessary. This was one of several ways in which the workers indicated that they would use the union to undertake tasks other than wage negotiations. One resolution of the 1923 conference aimed at the establishment of a voluntary organization to provide advice, which would prevent the masses from indulging in petty litigation in cases which could be settled out of court. Another principal concern was with unemployment, against which a petition was organized. Perhaps the most ambitious of the moves taken by the BGLU was its attempt to convene the first ever West Indian Conference in 1920. Unfortunately, only the Trinidad Working Men's Association was able to send delegates, the remaining territories expressing willingness but inability to attend. The chance to develop a common West Indian perspective for the labor movement was therefore lost, though workers' struggles in Trinidad were closely watched in Guyana. Rural Revolution. It is necessary to stress that the awakening among the Guyanese masses was countrywide, and not simply confined to the activities of the urban workers in Georgetown. The BGLU took an interest in plantation laborers also, though its activities on the plantations were severely limited by the managers' opposition to their laborers joining the union. East Indian laborers, for the most part, continued to use Crosby and the Immigration Department to voice their problems, asking prominent Indian lawyers to intercede on their behalf. This was by no means a passive arrangement. Both the Crosby and the Indian lawyers had to meet huge deputations who arrived in Georgetown from the particular plantation or area where the grievances were felt. Often, the whole plantation staff left en masse, as happened in 1917 and again in 1924 with labor from Ruinveld. On the latter occasion, there was an encouraging unity between rural and urban effort. 4,000 Indians and Negroes started to march on Georgetown with flags, sticks, and their tools, some to meet Critchlow at the BGLU office, and others to the Immigration Department to complain about irregular wages. Apart from the formation of the labor union, the initiative on the issues concerning the well-being of the masses came from the rural peasantry. The chairman of the Victoria Institute remarked in April 1919 that Georgetown looks to the East Coast to decide its political matters, and the facts did bear out this situation. The weapons which the rural proletariat and peasantry fashioned for their struggle included credit banks and agricultural societies, while the village councils and the village chairman's conferences provided forums for the expression of the will of the rural masses and their determination to confront the planter class. In February 1919, the Attorney General accused A.A. Thorne, a workers' representative in the combined court, of wanting to see a set of Bolsheviks in some village led by the village chairman. In reply, the chairman of the West Bank Agricultural Society noted that the Attorney General has brought in the ominous Russian term. The question was one of capital and labor. Labor was represented by the Farmers' Conference and the Village Chairman's Conference. Cane farming. One of the most significant trends during the war era was the development of a system of cane growing on a peasant farming basis. In 1897, a royal commission had recommended grants and aid to cane farmers. Very little was done by the government to implement the report, but farmers and sugar planters worked out private arrangements on some estates. The farmers faced considerable difficulties, such as the transportation of their cane to the factories and its unloading, but they organized themselves to overcome these problems and to win higher rewards from the sugar estates that purchased their product. In March 1919, the cane farming movement proposed legislation to regularize the relationship between the small cane farmer and the estate that bought and milled his cane. They pointed to Trinidad, where there was a small amount of legislation passed on the subject in 1902, though what the Guyanese farmers would have preferred was an extensive code such as that which was in existence in Queensland, Australia. Cooperative credit banks. Alongside the cane farming system, there sprung up the cooperative credit bank movement, since loans over the period from sowing to crop time were essential. In fact, credit facilities played an ever greater role in the young rice industry. A number of cooperative credit banks were established early in the century, but they became really important as the cane farming movement intensified, as the rice industry grew, and when the popularly influenced local government board took over the scheme in 1916. At the end of 1915, only 3 banks were registered. By the end of 1916, they had increased to 18. And by 1918, there were 26 cooperative credit banks in existence. The numbers of shareholders increased from 220 in 1915 to 5,815 in 1918. And in the same period, the working capital had risen from $611 to $28,000 and $20. The operations of the Ansgrove Clonbrook Cooperative Credit Bank can be taken as a typical example. During the year 1918, it issued loans to 156 shareholders amounting to $2,508. These extended over periods of from 1 to 12 months and involved sums from $5 to $20. Clients were chiefly paddy growers, along with provision and cane farmers, hucksters, coconut oil makers, and small businesses. Their efforts were obviously small, since there were narrow limits to what could be wrung from the colonial regime. The reaction of the plantocracy. Every one of the tendencies so far pinpointed represented a direct or potential threat to the old colonial system. The opening up of the interior, the end of Indian indenture, the rise of cane farming, and the organization of the proletariat were all seen by the plantocracy as undermining the structure of the sugar society. In the 1890s, when the gold fields were opened, the sugar planters found great difficulty in maintaining a steady supply of labor at the wages they offered, and this was the situation which gave rise to the Royal Commission in 1896. But the recommendation of the commission that crown lands should be opened up to peasants was anathema to the planters. According to J. Ellisar, a Georgetown solicitor, the crown lands were locked up and kept from the people's reach for many, many years, because it was thought by the planters that anything done to settle the people on the land would tend to take away labor from the sugar estates. That was common knowledge among the masses. By the end of the war, the planters were more anxious than ever, because bauxite, bellota, rice, gold, diamonds, cane farming, and irrigation schemes offered alternative employment to Guyanese workers formerly bound to the sugar estates. The planters therefore embarked on a counter-revolutionary offensive. After the 1896 commission, the proprietors of Verheid's Lust, Berbice River, encouraged the cultivation of canes on their estates by farmers, the lands being given free of rent. This practice was adopted by a number of other estates. In December 1918, the cane farmers were suddenly told that they would have to pay $9 and $12 per acre. No notice was given. Neither was there any increase offered to the farmers for their canes. La Bonne Mère was the only estate which did not pursue this reactionary policy. In vain did the farmers propose alternative schemes for the continuation of the cultivation of estate lands. What the planters wanted was an excuse to introduce legislation for further immigration, the only method which they knew to maintain the hierarchical plantation system. They took land out of production, which the cane farmers were eager to work, and within a short period, in Berbice alone, the estates of Adelphi, Canefield, Bath, Levertrait, Highbury, Goldstone Hall, and Everton were closed, ostensibly because of a shortage of labor, when in fact there were many people willing to work if only the starvation wages were increased. The colonization scheme. Early in 1919, the chairman of the Planters Association approached the Attorney General, claiming that there had been a reduction of 6,000 acres in the cane industry and that there was a prospect of greater reduction if planters did not get new supplies of labor. Out of this request was born the Colonization Bill, which aimed at introducing into Guyana another influx of cheap labor, preferably from India. The planters introduced the measure at a time when wartime defense of the colony regulations were still in force. Thorne complained that it was manifestly unfair that when the laborers who were interested in the matter were told they were not to deal with the matter as a result of the times in which they lived, that on the other hand, the capitalists could meet together and formulate a scheme. However, the workers refused to be gagged. They recognized the colonization scheme for what it was, an attempt to undercut local labor and keep them in a position of subjection. They campaigned vigorously against the proposal when it came before the combined court and warned the elective representatives that they should express popular opposition to the bill. A Chronicle editorial countered by saying that the elective members would be very foolish to be terrorized by agitators who warned them not to vote for these proposals at the peril of their seats. It hinted darkly that such action would supply the strongest arguments for the creation of Crown Colony government. Such threats did not stop the workers all over the country from making their position plain. Every one of the anti-colonization meetings held all over the country was a success, while the pro-colonization faction found that their meetings were invariably fiascos. Although the combined court did send a mission to England and India, nothing came of the colonization scheme. Nevertheless, it was the most important issue of public debate in Guyana at the end of the First World War, and it showed decisively how keenly the masses were assessing their colonial situation, and how determined they were to put an end to it. In the mood they were in, nothing escaped the vigilance of the masses. When the government introduced legislation to ban the import of Negro American literature, the workers fought this on two occasions. When a reactionary jury bill was brought forward, the workers again fought bitterly, though without success. And on yet another occasion, popular opposition nipped in the bud a proposal of the governor's that a vagrancy law should be passed to coerce laborers to work on public works at ridiculous wages. The Constitution. A reminder of the type of political system existing in Guyana is necessary at this juncture. In 1891, the Court of Policy, which was until then a purely nominated body, was reformed to allow the election of 14 members along with 8 members nominated by the governor, who together sat in the combined court. There were also 2 elected financial representatives, though the power over finance was constantly in dispute, because it introduced a clash with the executive authority of the governor. In any event, it took some time before the governing body reflected the change in the Constitution, the nature of that change being to give some representation to the colored and Portuguese middle class. Given the very narrow and restricted franchise, it is obvious that the new representatives in the combined court after 1891 were not elected by the workers and did not represent the workers. But some benefits were derived by having in the center of local political power a group of individuals who were opposed to the planter class and to many aspects of the old colonial system. For instance, as Raymond Smith noted, it is probably significant that the rice industry started at a time when the sugar industry was depressed, and when the new middle class were coming into power after the constitutional reforms of 1891. Besides, the middle class themselves were not satisfied. They clamored for more control over the affairs of the country, especially in the financial sphere. And as so often happens, they encouraged the workers to shout along with them to make as great a noise as possible. The year 1916 appears to have been decisive. A recall movement was launched against the then governor, Egerton, who had become unpopular with the Georgetown merchants because he interfered with their unwholesome speculation in rice exports. However, the middle class played to a public gallery, which had its own reason for abhorring the colonial system and its representative, the governor. The workers, too, began to take up the cry for a more democratic constitution and for a political program for their own betterment. As one correspondent of the Chronicle wrote in October 1918, "It is a common thought among the poorer peoples of this colony that places under British rule do not make rapid progress. Until the policy of the country gets into the hands of the people, through their representatives, it is bound to make slow progress." By the end of the war, the electorate was faced with a progressive party, which was not an organizational unit, but an alliance of politicians that had emerged out of the recall movement with the intention of capturing all 14 of the seats which were to be filled by election. Again, they identified themselves with the masses, and this itself was to provide grounds for disillusionment when they were successfully elected. Political influence of the masses. The influence which the workers wielded under the limited franchise of the pre-adult suffrage era is usually underestimated. The physical unrest of the masses was a factor which had always to be taken into account. During the first 3 decades of this century, disturbances and riots erupted with great frequency. Known as bread riots, one could not ask for more blatant examples of people asking for bread and being given bullets. The breathless haste with which the colonial regime read the Riot Act was a testimony to their deep-rooted fear of mass action that they had inherited from the sugar planters and slave owners. Quite apart from the threat of violence, the workers made an impact through public meetings. Georgetown workers met under the auspices of the BGLU to discuss the relative merits of Percy White and P.N. Cannon, concluding that the latter was an enemy of the working class. Workers in New Amsterdam met and demanded that Eustace Wolford should return to the constituency and give an account of his stewardship in the combined court, and especially to explain his ambivalence on the colonization bill which the workers had denounced. While peasant farmers of the East Coast Demerara met at Victoria Village, condemned the government in power, and agreed to form a political association embracing members from Anne's Grove and Bachelor's Adventure. All this was in the period after the recall movement and the formation of the Progressive Party, and it may appear futile because the workers had no vote. Yet the popular clamor had its effect on those who held the vote and those who appeared as representatives of the people. By 1923, for example, Cannon had lost the Georgetown mayoralty, and while he himself retained a seat in the combined court, the candidates whom he supported were all unsuccessful. Proof of the impact of popular agitation against the colonization bill came when the government itself decided to hold a number of public meetings to win support for the measure. The workers simply invaded those meetings, held in 1919, and passed resolutions of their own calling for improvements in sanitation, drainage and irrigation, and wages before they would consent to a further influx of immigrants. The suspension of the Constitution in 1928. Everyone felt that the Constitution of 1891 had outlived its usefulness. The middle class wanted more power, especially over the finances and the executive, while the planter class, having already ceded some of their authority to the middle class, and seeing the specter of mass power if more liberal reforms were granted, were willing to let the British Crown take direct responsibility for the colony of British Guiana. Dissatisfaction with constitutional forms was in fact general in the British West Indies after the war, and resulted in the appointment of a royal commission which visited the area and reported in 1922. The Wood Commission, as it was called, rejected the demands of the Guyanese planter class to take a step backward, but neither did it allow the presence of elected members on the executive as the Progressive Party requested. No important changes were made, so the elections of 1926 were held under the Constitution of 1891. A.R. Weber, one of Guyana's few historians and an individual who was himself personally involved in the politics of the period, wrote that the elections of October 1926 were fought with unexampled ferocity, and that the declaration at the polls showed a sweeping victory for the Popular Party, and a complete and devastating rout of their opponents, who were well possessed of this world's goods. But practically every seat was judicially challenged, and eventually 5 members of the Court of Policy were unseated on legal technicalities. No doubt, the Colonial Office was being informed of these developments, as well as receiving advice from the planter group to put an end to the Constitution, which gave power to the upstart middle class and encouraged the workers to dabble in politics. As mentioned before, as early as 1919, there were dark hints that if elected members allowed themselves to be influenced by popular agitators, this would supply the strongest arguments for the creation of a crown colony government. Again, in 1925, this idea was publicly voiced by the governor of British Guiana when he returned to England, and in 1927, when it was decided to put it into practice. No one quite knew what was the purpose of the commissioners who visited Guyana in 1927, at least not until the following year, when it became clear that they had been seeking excuses to suspend the Constitution. At any rate, the Constitution of 1891 was so radically changed that the effect was to remove all power from the elected representatives. It is clear that even the small measure of representation under the Constitution of 1891 was seen by the colonial regime as a threat. Thus, in 1928, not for the first time nor for the last, a constitutional coup d'etat was effected to break local resistance to the British imperial system. Race and class. Insofar as reflection on the period under discussion is understandably influenced by the present conjuncture of circumstances in Guyana, it is obvious that the question of the interrelation between race and class consciousness is of the utmost importance. In the decade after 1955, these two factors proved antagonistic, and consequently the anti-colonialist struggle of the Guyanese masses received a serious setback. However, Between 1900 and 1928, the situation was entirely different. Then it was the awareness among both Indians and Negroes of the peculiar disadvantages under which their own race labored that precipitated an attack on the colonial society. Racial consciousness was mobilized when a group felt it labored under special disadvantages. Indian opinion launched an attack on the government for keeping the East Indian masses in a state of illiteracy. It pointed out that of 20,000 children of East Indian parentage of school-going age, only 6,000 were attending school. This was branded as a neglect not only inexcusable, but culpable. On an issue such as this, communal anger was jointly directed against the colonial regime, because the Negro masses were at that very moment waging a struggle to lay the foundations of a more democratic educational system, rejecting the payment by result and other limitations which were in vogue since the Elementary Education Ordinance of 1876. Incidentally, the struggle of the teachers not only on their own behalf, but for a system of education which would benefit their peoples and the country, is undoubtedly one of the most magnificent in the annals of the history of the Guyanese working class. Apart from the demands for more education, there was also some consideration given to the curricula, and one of the suggestions of the East Indian community was that Indian languages should be taught. One striking feature of the debate on the issue by the Teachers' Association was the position taken by R. French, who argued that unless they took steps to teach Indian languages, the latter would disappear, as the African languages of the slaves had disappeared, and the community would be the poorer. This, and many other views on related topics, indicated that the racial groups in Guyana were seriously addressing themselves to an examination of where they stood, of what they possessed of value, and of what changes were desirable. At every juncture, they were unmasking the colonial society as the enemy. When in 1917 the East Indians succeeded in having marriage ceremonies by Mulvies and Pandits recognized, they had gained a victory over the white Christian capitalist conception of the society, and it was against this that the Negro masses, too, were directing their fire. They joined in the refrain of the Negroes of the United States that blacks had fought side by side with whites during the war, and now they should be given new opportunities. It is extremely significant that the colonial administration saw the associations, such as the Negro Progress Convention, not as racist groups, but as class formations. The literature from the United States was anathema because it was being widely read by the poorer classes of society, and it was suggested that the local branch of Garvey's movement should be banned because it was Bolshevik. The Reverend Frank wrote in January 1919 of the Negro masses of Guyana, "The possibilities wrapped up in them and the powers within them are immense." This applied equally to the East Indian masses. But for the release of the energies of all concerned, there was necessarily a process of self-realization, which was taking place in a framework of racial groupings rather than in the context of nation. That process of communal self-realization did not inevitably bring the races into conflict, nor retard the formation of organizations along class lines, nor weaken the struggle against colonialism. What occurred in the period after 1955 was that communal awareness was for various reasons turned inwards to exacerbate racial contradictions among the Guyanese workers and peasants. I say exacerbate because racial conflict in Guyana was an inevitable concomitant of the fact that indentured labor, East Indian, Chinese, and Portuguese, was conceived specifically to break the back of Negro opposition to the planter class. Throughout the decades after Indian immigration began in 1838, there were differences over wages between racial groups on the sugar estates, brought about by the deliberate policy of the planters of playing one group off against another. No doubt, racial conflict fed racialism, and vice versa. And indeed, there are a host of other such interconnections that one could make. What is certain is that simple and definitive explanations must give way to a more sober analysis of the complexities of the development of the Guyanese mass movement, of the relationship between racial consciousness and racial prejudice, between economic competition and racial conflict, between communal identification and class objectives. 3. Marxism and African liberation. First of all, we must understand the background for this kind of debate. When one is asked to speak on the relevance of Marxism to Africa at this particular time, one is being asked to involve oneself in an historical debate, an ongoing debate in this country, particularly among the black population. It is a debate which has heightened over the last year, and from my own observations, it is being waged in a large number of places across this country.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.